Thank you very much. Thank you so much. I'm really pleasant and I'm very happy to be here. It's really an honor for me to be this lecture series and also a pleasure to be in Athens. Yeah, so we're going to be talking about crystallization. So crystal formation from a rational and rigorous mathematical viewpoint. And I like to be lecturing on very classical stuff, but still there will be something new, at least the movies. So I have to put the names of my collaborators on this, Eduardo Mainini and Paolo Piovano, who are both postdocs with me, and Eduardo was, and Hideki Wakawa, a colleague from Japan. Okay, so crystals. Here are some nice pictures. What is a crystal? To tell you the truth, I don't really know. And there's also a big debate on what is a crystal. Let's say it's a solid, which has some patterning at the micro scale. So if you look from very, very close, you see some pattern. So something like the first picture there. The second is water, that's a snowflake. We all love it, especially in this season. This third picture in this line remembers me that there is some technology that is still going around crystal formation. That's a picture of an epicaxial growing structure. So it's a crystal that is growing by deposition, and these are the various layers that you see there. Okay. These are pictures too, but still crystals are 3D objects. And so this is a picture or a drawing that has to remember me that this can also be 2D and 3D and could also be made of different species hanging together like this crystal of molecules. That's exactly the structure of salt, of sodium chloride. And again, there are more complicated structures like this two-dimensional structure here, which we refer to as graphene. It's a two-dimensional crystal made of pure carbon, which can be rolled up to tubes like this one. This is a nanotube. Or it could be closed like a ball. This example here, which should be moving also. Yeah. Oops. Oops. Okay, so this is a cage made of 60 carbon atoms, which are binded inversely. This is a fullerene. So surprisingly enough, we don't really know answers to these three questions. So why do crystals form, really? And why do they take the geometry that they take? And why such structures like this one, you see it's a kind of a three-dimensional structure built on a two-dimensional kind of relation emerges. So to these three questions, we don't have really rigorous and rational answers yet. And I would like to tell you a little bit why it's so difficult. So now I have to do the new, right? Okay, so you can see from my slides, I'm not going to be really doing a slide presentation here. I'm using the board most of the time. I'm using the beamer just to show you movies as you see and pictures. Okay, so. Okay, so what we believe is that these structures emerge because particles are in relation one to the other, and the relation between particles or molecules is going to be governed by quantum mechanics. So the answer should be there, should be quantum mechanics, meaning it should be in the Schrödinger equation, right? So now I'm going to be kind of talking rapidly. This is the maximum value, right? So as I said, the answer should be in quantum mechanics. I like to write the Schrödinger system for a system of n atoms, n nuclei. So let's say n, small n nuclei, with positions x1, x small n, and with charges. Big N electrons. So the Schrodinger equation is very, very complicated, so we do some approximation to it. We take a time independent. We take it non-relativistic. And most importantly, we take it under the so-called Born-Oppenheimer approximation. This approximation says that in principle nuclei are so heavy that they stay still, electrons move around, so I can solve the problem for the electrons first by leaving the nuclei fixed. So I imagine the nuclei are fixed and I solve just for the electrons, just to simplify the problem. So the problem is then formulated in terms of the so-called wave function. It's a function with a lot of variables. So it's defined on R3 times Z2 to power Dn and has complex values. So for every electron, I have a copy of R3, and also a copy of R3. This accounts for the spin. So this will represent the position of the electron. This is its spin. And in a time independent case, this wave function is going to be a solution to H. Of course, let's do it like this. So let's take the energy
already.
So I will define an energy depending on the vector x to be the integral of the Z2. Psi is a function of these variables here. I call them y. And h is going to be a function of x and y. Maybe y and s. And then psi again y and s, and I'm integrating into y ds. Where h is the Newtonian. This is the molecular Newtonian. Which in this case is so is the sum over, let's call it j 1 to capital N of the Laplacian in the variables y for the electrons, and then I have with the 1/2, so let's put over 1/2. This is the charges, and then xi minus xj, and then finally the attracting piece, which is the sum I from 1 to 1, so I and j, and here I put the z I xi minus yj. So there is an operator, it's a differential operator, meaning it contains derivatives, the derivatives are here, just in the y variables. And it has a potential part. This potential part is made up of three pieces which add up together. The first piece says that the electrons do not really like to be very, very close. If you get them very close, this is going to be very much like this one, and you have in your energy something that is like 1 over something very small. That's bad. And nuclei do not want to be very close, you see here. This is Zi, the charge of nuclei I, charge of nuclei J, and this is again the distance between the nuclei. And this one is the attraction of electrons to nuclei. This is the point where a nucleus is, this is the point where the electron is, and this is the charge, which is taking them together. Okay. So this is the molecular Hamiltonian. I'm using this differential operator. I'm applying it to the wave function, that function there, and I'm applying it again to the conjugate of that. The wave function has a symmetry, which I'm going to put over here. So the wave function belongs to a set of admissible wave functions, so A and admissible. And these are the wave functions which we want to put here. We belong to H1 of all y variables. H1 is in L2, we've created in L2. And they are anti-symmetric, meaning that if you exchange the position of two electrons, so yi, si, yj, sj, these are the dependencies, so this is y at electron I and electron j with the spin I and j. If you switch these two electrons, you have to change sign. So this is minus yj sj, and then here yi si. And so if you change the role of these two electrons, you get a minus sign. This means that this is anti-symmetric. Okay, since we're talking about admissible functions, let's also fix the norm. Let's say that the norm is in a plus one. That's E there, that's the energy, which tells me what's the energy related to this wave function. The wave function is just an x1 function with this strange anti-symmetry with norm 1. So what I want to do, I want to define of the energy. You see, the energy is just a function of x, that's the position of the nuclei, because the position of electrons and spins have been integrated out. You don't see them anymore. Okay? So really the energy depends just on the position of the nuclei. And I'm taking the minimum over the set of admissible functions. The admissible functions are normalized to norm 1. Which means that this is really the Rayleigh quotient of the molecular Hamiltonian. So this is the smallest eigenvalue. Okay, so maybe say it again. So I assume that basically the nuclei are fixed, and I solved for the electron. So I wrote what's the energy of this system in terms of the electrons. And then I took that wave function which realizes the minimum of the energy. That's the smallest eigenvalue. Well, I have a function, this d here, which depends just on the position of the nuclei. Okay. Okay, so this function here, I will call it a configurational function. Configurational. Functional. It's a nice function which takes values in configuration, so positions of the n nuclei, and as a real value. So the energy
on the other one
is related to this one.
Yes.
But then I'm taking a minimum with respect to psi. So psi from here on plays no role because I just selected that very special upside that realizes the minimum sort of disappears. It's like infinity. Okay, so from now on, I have a real function defined on the position of the nuclei of my system. I just want to see what are these positions that make this function minimal, this configurational function minimal. I say my system is so right, it's going to put the nuclei in the very position that minimizes this configurational function of here. Okay. Okay, this is basically all I have to say about quantum, because so I've been hiding some big leap here. So the Schrödinger system is a nightmare, and the reason is, for me at least, dimensions. So we said that we need a copy of R3 for every single electron in our system. So this means that if I have a carbon atom, which has 6 electrons, I need to basically solve the PDE in 18 dimensions. So that is, if I... So if I need to have a solution, omega solutions to this, I will take R, and I will approximate R by choosing grid points on R, maybe 10 grid points. Will that be enough to approximate R? Probably not, but let's say 10 grid points. And then I have to compute all this program for one single atom of carbon, which means 6 electrons. And so the grid points for the very problem, so for C, I need 10 to the power 18 grid points. Just because the dimension of the Schrödinger system is 18. Right? And this is for one atom. If I want to compute the exact structure that we saw, like kind of a little ball, that's made of 60 atoms. It's called C60, and we're going to be coming back to this later. So for the C60, so what is it? I mean, this one to the power 60, right? Which means 10 to the 110, how many? So let's see. So I need 18 for every atom, so 180. So 90, 180. 1,080. Which is surely a very, very big number of points. Just to have a comparison, 10 to the power 80 is approximately what's believed to be the number of atoms in the observable universe. So this would be atoms in the universe. So we are never, ever going to be computing the structure of C60 by looking to the Schrödinger system, because that's just too complicated. Not now, not with a quantum computer, it's not going to be possible. Right? So we need to do something, and something I propose you to do is to take this big leap with me, take a breath and jump, and say that we know what's the form of this configurational function, which we don't. We really don't, and we can just compute in very, very special cases, and not for the C60. But let's assume that we have this configurational function. It's really an assumption, nobody will ever compute it. So let's assume. And from now on, let me forget about quanta. So I'm forgetting quanta now, and I'm starting again with the configurational function. So I said I want to look to configurations. configurations for me are going to be sets of points. Let's say finitely many points. So x1, xn, we're going to set these points in RD, maybe, different dimension. And on this configuration, I would like to have a function which tells me what's the energy of this choice of points, or D. Again, a function from B to power small n to r. What could that be? Let's see. So a configuration could be something like this. So I choose points. So maybe x1, x2, xi, xj. And the easiest possible energy that I can think of is something like this, V equal to the sum I different from J of sine V2 xi minus xj. So for any pair xi xj, I add up a term in this sum, which just depends on the distance between xi and xj. This V2 is an interaction potential. So let's see. It could be something like this. This is V2 as a function of its argument. So why is this form? This form says that all particles would like to stay at some distance one to the other, let's say distance one. Because if they all sit at distance one, for every pair sitting at distance one, I get in my energy this contribution, which is negative. I like negative energy. I like very low energies, right? I'm looking for minimal energies. I don't have it anymore, but it's minimal energy. So let's say that this is at level minus one. So the energy says that particles do not want to stay too close to each other, otherwise the energy is very big. So too close particles are not favored. And it's better they don't stay too far apart from each other, because the energy is higher if you stay too far apart from each other. It's better if you stay at distance one. So this particular form of energy is usually referred to as Lennard-Jones potential. Lennard-Jones potential, which can have the explicit expression, let's say V2 of R or L equals to 1 over L to some power 12 minus 1 over L to power 6. And then in order to make it minimize that 1, I put a 2. And then if I put a 2, then the minimum is really at minus 1. So that's so this is a function that looks like this. So when L, which is this distance, is close to zero, these terms dominate. So you get something very, very positive. When you get far from zero, that term dominates. So you get something small and negative, like this is. It has just one minimum in one, and the value is minus one. So that's the minimum chance. Okay, so the question. So the question now that I have my configurations and I have my configuration energy is, who are the minimizers? So the crystallization problem. Is always the same. So R, the minimizer, R, the minimizer, the minimizing configurations. Periodic. we said. A crystal is a solid structure patterning. So R minimizes of those configurations periodic. It's a nice question because you see, in the energy, as you see there, V, the configuration is coming in just by pairwise relations. So the only thing that matters to me is how I'm far from him and the same is for him. And now we're asking something which is global. So by just minimizing this thing, which looks like a local thing, can we get something which is really periodic? Crystals are really big things. So relations are the scale of angstroms. That is 10 to the minus 10 meters. So one angstrom, 10 to the minus 10 meters. And crystals can grow as big as centimeters or even meters. So let's say 1 meter. So 1 meter. So this process, so this fact that I minimize it is periodic, has to be a really big thing. So it makes me scale 10 light scales, which is like going from here to the center of Aachen or from here to the center of the sun. It's really a big thing. So is this hiding in this pairwise relation that I have? Okay, so I have to mention that this one is a very old problem. Of course it's very old. Crystals have been observed since ever, and this question has been set a long time ago, and it's a very interesting one, because it's estimated that roughly one-third of the solid material on Earth is crystalline, so it's a very big portion of solids, basically in the center of the Earth. So the first paper is considered on this subject. Goes back to 1611 in the paper by Kepler. And it's a wonderful paper where it reflects on why water should crystallize in this kind of six-fold symmetry like the snowflakes. So the paper starts that he's crossing the Charles Bridge in Prague, and this snowflake gets into his lapel. So he observes the symmetry, and he says this has to have something related with relations between particles, in a sense. He was thinking, so it's coming from vapor, vapor has no direction, so if it crystallizes like this, there should be a reason. And so this one is considered to be the first paper that poses this question in a rational way. In fact, in this paper, there is the statement of this conjecture. The famous Kepler conjecture that says that the densest possible packing of equal spheres non overlapping in 3D has a specific density. It's a conjecture that has been solved finally in 2002. So it took us 400 years. And it's not exactly related to crystallization, but it has some contact. So we'll talk about this maybe later on. So this is a paper by Kepler. In fact, Kepler was writing this paper as a Christmas gift to a friend. So can you imagine how Christmas is coming? It would be great to have it like this one, have your own since like every year. Okay. So it's a very old problem, but it's also a very new one. Basically everything we know comes from the 80s, or from the late 70s. There is an enormous literature in computation and in physics, but in mathematics it's not that big. And papers are probably like 12 or so. So there are not these many papers. Maybe that now it's time to get started. Maybe to just little piece to now state what's going to be the outline of my lectures. It's going to be the easiest possible outline. And this is a problem that depends very much on dimensions. So the easy stuff is in 1D, and then it gets critical in 2D, and almost everything is open in 3D. So this will be my outline. So I start from 1D, and I will try to increase the difficulty to 3D. So the first thing that I want to mention is that I need to be choosing an energy V, or actually a density V2. In fact, we can imagine energy is to be functions of interaction between two particles, as we said. So functions of maybe xi and xk. But also maybe energy which are function of three particles. So maybe xi, xj, xk, and maybe some other terms, depending on four or five particles, and so on. So this, in fact, has been done by multiple experiments. The important thing is that I don't want really to see coordinates in my problem. So I'm always going to be asking V to be invariant by its own axis. So if I have a minimal configuration here, the same configuration down there is going to be minimal again. And the rotation of the circuit is going to be minimal again. So this is why, if I just have two, so this V was before, just what we call a two-body interaction, like this one, then it has to be a function just of the distance, because that's an invariant by its own axis. It cannot be anything more complicated than this. Okay, so let's start from this. We already have an example of a potential that we like, is the Lennard-Jones. It's attractive in the long range, and it's repulsive at the short distance. Is it the best potential? Is it better than others? We don't know. Maybe we don't know, because we said to justify the form of this guy, we should look to the Schrödinger system, and we should look at this at zero temperature, which is not possible. So this is really an idealized thing. It's by no reason the only possibility. In fact, it's not the only possibility. So the first time I was talking to my colleagues in computational chemistry, they showed me a book. The book was a kind of encyclopedia, like this big, of functionals, possible functionals for this or that or the other purpose. And the Lennard-Jones was there, but it was just one of the examples. But we're going to be keeping this in mind because it's a reference. Okay. We need another example of a functional. It is the one that we call the sticky functional. It's like the Lennard-Jones, meaning attractive in the long run and repulsive in the short run, but it's kind of a skeleton for this one. So, so I take the same value, the same minimizer and the same minimum. So here, again, at distance one, particles distance one, this is minus one as before. As for the Lennard-Jones, the same. But then as particles do not really like to be too far apart, I set it to be zero. And as particles do not like to be very close together, I set it to be very, very high here, ideally plus infinity. So I will do this, meaning that this is plus infinity. So now you see why it's called sticky, because it gives you the value minus one if your particles are exactly a distance one to the other. They cannot be closer because the energy is going to be infinity. They can be far apart, but then the energy just doesn't see it, because it's just a zero. So this is very, very repulsive in the short range, zero attractive in the long range, but has some similar features with respect to this one. So the fact that this is plus infinity here is usually called a hardcore interaction. It's called like this because we imagine that these particles actually are kind of hard, like disks, and they cannot interpenetrate, so the centers of the disks cannot be so close together. This is the hardcore. And I'd like to make another drawing about this difference here. This is very important. This is again Lennard-Jones. And then maybe other is the same, but gets to be zero. So the difference between one and the other is that one is zero from some point on, the point is square root of d. They look dissimilar, but they are not. So Lennard-Jost is a kind of a long tail, very, very small, but long tail, which means that in this relation, every particle is in a relation with all the other particles. For the yellow function, this is not true, because if you get to some distance, you don't see each other anymore. So this case here is called long-range interaction. So this is long-range. And the yellow one is short range. And if you get in relation with the yellow one, you just have a relation with your first neighbors. So the system is simpler. So again, one thing before going to 1D, for the crystallization in 1D, put it here. So this thing is important. So long range versus short range is very important. There's a big difference between these results. So you can put some, okay, so some red around here to sign this difference. Another big difference is how many particles you have. So if you have a finite number of particles versus an infinite number of particles. So for the finite number of particles is exactly that. So for finite, you just take the sum over all particles of this d2. This is a finite sum, because so these are n, let's say. So these pairs are n squared. And then the pairs on the diagram, don't count them, because here's where the function could be undefined. So it's n squared minus n. So this is really a finite sum. Of course, you know why I'm taking one out, right? Because if I change xy with xj, I don't want to count this two times, because we're in one half. So if you have infinite particle, you cannot do this thing, because you cannot sum up this and be sure that it's going to be a finite sum for the time. So what people do, they look to density. So let's say V has to be defined as the limit, if existing, with the number of particles goes to plus infinity of the energy of a finite sub configuration of n particles. This is the energy for n particles. Normalized by n. So I put V into this. So as n gets big, the energy can also be very, very big, but I'm going to divide it by n. I assume that I have this limit. This one is a density. I'm not going to be looking at the energy, but at the density of energy. This is another experience, finite versus infinite. Okay, so of course, you can guess with me what's going to be the easiest possible setting in 1D to describe crystallization. That's the one we're going to start with. What does it mean to crystallize in 1D? So I have just R, I have particles on R. They want to minimize an energy like this one. They want to change position in such a way that minimizes this energy. And the crystal is like a distribution of these beads on this line, an equidistant distribution of beads. So the easy one is the finite and short range. Finite crystallization, short range, 1D. So I have a line, I want to put on this line particles in such a way that they minimize a short-range energy, a yellow energy like that one. All right? So the first line is always free. I put it here, for instance. That's the first particle. The second one, where do I put the second one? So if I have just two particles, so if I have n equal to 2, I want to put the second at distance 1 from this first one. There's no way to make better than this one. So for two particles, that's the ground state. Of course, again, you can translate it so by isometry, right? It's unique. So let's do maybe two particles, three particles. Three particles is the same, right? So you set a particle to the left, one to the right. At distance 1, this is again the ground state. Okay, so finite short range is stupid. You just have to put these particles at distance 1. That's going to be a ground state. So what happens if you go infinite? So we have finite, this is infinite. And again, short range. One thing. Let's try to put on this line an infinite number of particles, or to start somewhere. So we'll just start from two particles again. So for two particles, they sit at distance 1. I'm sorry, an infinite number of particles. I want to show that in this case, infinite and short range is a crystal. So I assume that it's not. So what I do, I take a distribution of particles which is not a crystal, meaning that some of these are not at distance 1 and to the other. So let's say that here I have something which is closer. Can you see it's closer? It's not a distance 1, it's a little bit closer. It should be here, but it's there. And then you have the others. So if you have something like this, what you do, you consider this pair, which is non-optimal. You take this one and you shift it to get distance 1. You shift this one, and shift all the others of the same amount. So since the energy is short range, the fact that this one moved has no effect on everything on the left. Right? It's kind of a rigid motion. This two comes to the right distance, which is 1. So this is a transformation which lowers the energy. Which means that what I had before, which was not crystallized, was not a ground state because it could lower the energy. Right? So this proved that for infinite many beads on the line, short range interaction, there is crystallization. So the only ground state is.
I think if you shift all the others, it means that the particle you shifted it now, the larger distance for all the others are right.
Yeah, but this is short range. So the fact that this one is a little bit farther from this one than before makes no difference.
Can you assume that the square root of d is always smaller than any other known one distance?
Right. Yes. So they are already around 1, and then. Okay, so this was for short range things. Now let's look to long range. Maybe I can do it here. So I start again. I start from finite particles, long range. Finite particles, but now long range. So everybody in relation with everybody. So what happens again? When I am equal to 2, I just put 2 particles at distance 1. But then for n equal to 3, if I add 1, what happens, it can be computed, but it's also natural, is that they don't stay at distance 1 anymore. They get a little bit closer. So this one gets here, and this one gets here. It's a 0.9. The point is that this one to the left is feeling the attraction of this one to the right, so it wants to be closer to the center of mass. Of course, it gains something because now this distance is non-optimal, but it's getting something because it's getting closer to the other one. And that's the integral state. It's still crystalline, in a sense, it's periodic. But now I do the n equal to 7. For the n equal to 7, what I have is this. I hope you can see it. So the further you get to the left and the right, the more these distances get squeezed. Because this one is feeling the attraction of all the other particles to the right. Whereas this one is feeling the attraction to the right by this small number of particles and some attraction to the left also. So this one is maybe 0.8, and then 0.7, 0.6 or so. So surprisingly, finite crystallization with long range in 1D doesn't exist. So the ground state is not periodic. It's not a subset of a periodic lattice. Right? So this is non-crystallization. Crystallization. And we could still ask what happens for infinite many particles in the long range regime. This is a relevant question. So now I put here infinite and long range. This is a question that's been solved now. So what they observed that was that by adding particles, all distances between particles decrease. So you just add one particle here, all the other particles are going to be closer and closer and closer. So the observation is that the distance xi minus x squared decreases with n. Put the extra particles and they all shrink. If you have an infinite number of particles, it's there is an argument that's about the symmetry region. You cannot imagine that these are denser in some region with respect to others, which means that at the end you have a crystalline situation where all the particles have the same distance, which is probably 0.6. In fact, they did this computation exactly for the Leonard Jones, which I mentioned before, and this distance is 0.98. It's a little bit less than 1. But there is a crystal. So this is good news, but before changing, I want to tell you also the third thing. So another good news is this one. So if I already knew that there was a crystal, I can express for you the energy per particle. I could say that the energy per particle is something like the minimum of the sum for, let's say, small z is a big z of v2 of cz, and here I put a c. So look what I'm doing. I'm assuming that my ground state is a crystal, so it's z, or it's a copy of z. I don't know how big is the spacing. I'm saying the spacing is c. And then I'm saying, what's the energy of the particle which stays at the origin? And the energy of that particle is the sum of all the contributions of all the others, which are position cz from it. So I get this number. This is the energy per particle. And this magic c, which is the one that realizes this number, is exactly this distance. So let me write here inward. Three things that we learned. Or maybe two that we learned and one that I'm commenting now. So first one, there is no crystal for infinite long range. For finite long range, And the reason is still on the board. If you have a finite number of particles, long range, you have this distortion at the end, which is a kind of surface effect, no crystals. The second is that crystallization is always the combination of two effects. A local one, which tells you what's the right structure, and a global one that tells you that this structure has to be attained. So it's always a local plus a global thing. So the argument in both the infinite cases work was a kind of a global thing. So I need to be moving all particles global. And here I need to be able to compute this energy per particle here, which is again a global thing. We're going to be seeing global things now. The last thing that I want to put on the board before changing to 2D is this crystallization is very, very delicate to the choice of D2 or 2D. So very delicate. To perturbation, very sensitive to perturbation. So crystallization here holds for nanojones. There is another paper that I have to quote. Give me a second. Hamrick and Berlin again. So in this paper it's shown that if you take a C1 small perturbation of nanojoules. C1 small means, so uniformly small and also derivatives uniformly small of the V2, then you can destroy crystallization. So it's very sensitive, not just to the fact of being finite or infinity or long range or short range, but the choice of the functional geometry. In 1D, you can do C1 small perturbation and destroy everything.
So the result is only for the nanojoules?
Is for the nanojones and for a lot of things that work like nanojones, but not for everything in the world. This perturbation here is, as you can imagine, so they are perturbing around the minimum with some little wiggles, and then there they're sitting atoms. And they're proving that this works. Actually, they produce a quasi-crystal. Oh yes, so let's try an application to this to Cauchy ball. So what is Cauchy ball is a classical assumption from, let's say, crystals to macroscopic solids. So the idea is the following. So you take your crystal, 1D crystal now, you pin it to the wall, it's a crystal. So it's equally spaced. And now you impose a macroscopic displacement, which means that you take this last atom here and you pull it a little bit. Like here. And usually we say that the Cauchy-Born assumption is satisfied if this macroscopic displacement is reflected by the same crystal displacement, meaning I'm taking this from position 1 to position possibly 1 plus s, and inside all particles are displacing at the same time. Is it the right number of particles? So we said that in this case, the Cauchy-Born assumption hypothesis is fulfilled. So this is okay for Cauchy-Born. Let me picture the example which is not okay for Cauchy-Born. I'll do this one. One, 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 one. So you pull a little bit, and in the material, you don't know what happened. So Cauchy-Born is, let's say, a fine macro strains imply fine micro strains.
Said very badly, probably.
Okay. So let's see if we can use this. Crystallization business to discuss this Cauchy-Born assumption. So I'd like to see what happens to the ground state if I pull it. So I'm pulling the ground state. Okay, so I'd like to see what happens. So who's the ground state when I pull it? So I want to minimize my energy under the constraint that, so maybe the first particle is at zero and the last one is not at one anymore, but now at one plus s. Okay, so let's call this particle x1 and the last one xn. Okay. But this is just a function of the distances. So I can rephrase everything in terms of distances. I can say I want to minimize 1/2 of the sum of the of these distances, di, where now di is xi minus x. Maybe xi plus 1 minus xi. Under the constraint that the sum of the di is equal to 1 plus s. So how many di's do I have? So the first one is d1, the last one is dn minus 1. So I have n minus 1 of this di's. And the sum of all these has to be 1 plus s. So now what I use is that my functional has this very nice form. And for the ground states at di is just here. And around here, the function is complex. And this. So it's a complex function, so it's the sum of different evaluation of the complex function. This is bigger or equal than the mean. Sorry, so the d I put it here, and then I put the di inside. This has to be the mean. So let's see, I put how many I have, n minus 1. And here the mean, 1 over n minus 1 of the sum of the beta. Okay. So the sum is inside because V is convex. It's not convex all the way. So here, where it gets to be very, very flat, it's not convex. But I'm just looking around the minimum because I'm very little perturbing around the ground state. This is a number. I know the sum of these guys is 1 plus s over n. So this is really the minimum, minus 1 over 2, and then v of 1 plus s n minus 1. There is no actual need to have this minimum now because I've summed everything, so I can cancel the minimum. I just add this number. And this number corresponds to exactly n minus 1 pairs at this distance, one to the other. Okay. So the ground state. Has, if you like, all the DIs have to be 1 plus s over n minus 1. So these are equally spaced, which means that by pooling macroscopically this specimen, I have that the crystals are arranged in such a way that all the distances are the same. All the distances, depending on I, are the same, but this depends, doesn't depend on I. Okay, so in this case, with this complexity here, the Shibori is okay. So we can get something which is more like macroscopic by this microscopic intuition on why these crystals fall this way. Again, let's change, we said it's very sensitive, so let's change the functional and see if it's already still there. Let's change it for the sticky functional. So let's imagine you have a sticky functional. Again, I'm taking my ground state and I'm pulling it. What's going to be happening? Is it true that Cauchy bar is going to be fulfilled again? No, absolutely not. So if I have my sticky ground state, that's the ground state where all particles have distance 1, and I pull it like this, what's going to be happening? Some of these have to have distance more than 1. And as soon as they do, they will lose some energy, because as soon as you move from the minimum, you get a plus 1 in the energy. You're losing something. If you break all these bonds, you're losing 4 in energy. If you just break 1, you're losing 1. So you need to be breaking something, but you don't have to be break. You shouldn't be breaking more than 1. So for instance, this one, is a ground state for the sticky potential under this macroscopic state. And as you see, there are gaps which are longer than 1, so this doesn't fulfill the Cauchy Born assumption. So here Cauchy Born is okay, here Cauchy Born is, here no Cauchy Born. So it's an example of the sensitivity to the function. Okay, so now it's time for two dimensions. One dimension we finished, let's go to 2D. Again, we're starting from the easy and getting to the more difficult. So the easy 2D is finite and short range. Actually, even easier, finite and sticky. I repeat again the idea of the sticky potential. You don't have particles, you have disks. They have some radius, which is 1/2. And you care about the centers. Oops. They want to touch each other. Every time two disks touch, you get a -1 in the energy. And but they cannot be so close. So the centers have to be at least a distance 1. Because these are rigid disks. Okay, so with this N disks, how much can you lower the energy? What's the ground state of the energy? So what you do, actually, you're counting the maximum number of tangencies. You're trying to maximize the number of tangencies. So these disks want to touch each other, you want to maximize this number of touchings, tangencies. So this problem looks very much like another one, which is the one that's called the kissing problem. The kissing problem is like this. B. So you take a sphere in RD with radius 1/2. So how many spheres can you, non-overlapping spheres, can you organize in such a way that they all touch the central sphere? So KD is going to be the maximum number of spheres. Touching the central one. And this is what is called the kissing number. So the spheres around kiss the central one. So this is the central one. So in 1D, D equal to 1, the kissing number is 2. So every time you take an interval, which is a sphere in 1D, you can kiss it from left and from right, and not more. In 2D, the kissing number is 6. Because you can always kiss a disk with other 6 disks of the same radius, like this. So, kissing in 1D is 2, kissing in 2D is 6. So the idea of finding the maximum number of tangencies between disks in 2D should be related to something like this. So this should look like the configuration that one has to produce. And this is locally so. Locally, the best thing to do would be to put all these disks in such a kind of an hexagonal configuration. If you think about the center of these disks, you will see that the lattice that you are going to be producing is a regular triangular lattice. But as I said, so for to crystallize, you need local and global arguments. This is local. So I'll be sure that this is going to be also a good recipe in the whole. And the answer is yes. Again, this is a result by Raiden. This is typing already. So they proved together that the ground state for the sticky potential is a subset of the regular triangular lattice. For to do this, they used basically a combinatorial result, which is due to Arbot. Was a little bit older and was saying that if you give me n disks like this, the maximum number of tangencies between these disks is like, so this maximum number, I will call it p, is minus 3n minus the square root of 12n minus 3. So this sign that I'm using here is the integral part. So the integral part of x is the maximum of all settings which are smaller than x. And the result variable says that the maximum number of these tangents you can do is this one. I'm putting a minus because the energy is counting minus one for every tangency. We don't really need this number very much, so I'm going to be raising it very soon, but let's have a look at it. So it says that, so with n, this is the leading order with n, and the coefficient here is 3. This is because in the optimal configuration, every particle, let's say, has 6 bonds, and every bond is shared by 2 particles. So it has 6 bonds over 2, 3. And then there is another term, which is this one lower order. So this is lower order. This takes into account the surface. Right, so you have a finite number of these atoms, n. There should be a surface of this configuration. Surface is going to be not that much optimal because you cannot have 6 bonds active at every point in the surface. You have some little less. And so the energy is bigger, minus, bigger energy. But this is lower order. So this is the surface term. Okay, so this one was the first crystallization result in 2D. It was commented to be a little bit rigid because the sticky potential is really a great idealization of two-body interactions. And so it was extended just in 1981, again by Radin. By choosing this potential, so again, hardcore, again, minus one. But then something like this, a fine. So you see it, 1 slash minus 1, and then a fine. And this point here is exactly 25 over 24. It's not sticky. It is a little piece here, which is a fine, like this one. This number is not very important, but it's a very small number, in a sense, compared to 1. So the idea by Radin here was to show that actually his results were not exactly sitting only on Arbor theorem, but were kind of more general and could accommodate some situations like this one. In fact, up to now, this is the last function for which we know crystallization to be. It's a very rigid function, it has an affine piece here, but we don't know crystallization for anything better than this. By now. Let me see if I can explain you how does this work. I'd like to show you what Radin is doing. Is actually an induction proof. It wants to prove that for n increasing, ground states are subsets of the triangular lattice. So let's start for something that looks like what I think, but maybe it's not. This one is, but it's a little bit distorted, so it's not exactly what it should be. This one in the middle has 5 bonds and not 6. So he says the energy of this guy has to be the sum of two energies. So one which is related to the bulk, and one that comes from the boundary. So the bulk energy is the bulk that you would have if you, the energy of all the particles which are inside the structure. So away from this boundary polygon, which always exists because I have a finite number of particles. So this would be bulk. And the boundary part is all the rest. So if I remove this boundary polygon, how much do I have, how much the energy is dropping? This is the boundary energy. And then he says, okay, so at every point at the boundary, I have a specific energy. That's the energy that I would lose if that point disappears, counting one, the bonds that get inside, and let's say one half those that stay at the boundary, because at the end, these are bonds between atoms at the boundary. So I'm just counting one, the one inside, one half the others. And what it proves is that this energy which is related to this atom may be xk. Is controlled by the angle alpha k over pi over 3. Alpha k is this angle. And it's another color. How can this be? Well, if this angle is not big enough, then this one is going to be to have a small number of neighbors. So small energy. Small angle, small energy. If this angle is big, it might be that it has more neighbors. Like this one, you see the angle is very big. Right? And it has four neighbors. In fact, this is so, and in order to prove this is using this slope here. It's a very complicated argument, but this is what it's doing. This is a local thing. So how is it turning these things to be global? So the idea is this one. So he's saying, so the energy, then so the energy, what is it again? Is the bulk plus all these boundary pieces. I have to sum up all these angles. These are internal angles of a polygon. If I have d atoms at the boundary, it's going to be a polygon made of d sides. So the sum of the internal angles of this polygon is going to be pi times d minus d. This is the sum of the angles, and then I have to divide by pi over 3. So the energy is actually the energy of the bulk plus 3 times d minus 6. So here is one spot where the globality comes in. We are summing up all these angles and recalling that the sum of these angles have to have a specific value. That's this number here, the sum of the internal angles of a D polygon, of a D gon, so a polygon with D sides. So let's have a look to this number again. Let me picture a big hexagon. Oops. Let's see if I can make it. Is it? Almost. Okay. So what he says with this relation is that any point at the boundary, any of these d's, is counting 3. So if I remove any of these d, I'm losing 3. So this is the d that I'm talking about. If I remove that d, I'm losing 1 half here, 1 half here, 1, 1. I'm losing 3. That's correct. And every point at the boundary has to have this specific situation, apart from 6 exceptions, which are the one that produce this minus 6. And where are these exceptions? Let's see. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. This one do not have four bonds, just have three bonds. One internal, two external. So this is one, this is 1/2, this is 1/2. So this compared to 3 is losing 1. So it's a -1 × 6. -1 × 6 is -6. Okay. So in this formula, it kind of condensed this concept that it was looking to structures like this hexagonal one, where some atoms at the boundary are going to be special, more special than others, because they have this number of bonds that are exactly 6, and all the others are 3. So D, again, I said the bulk plus 3D minus 6, but then V bulk is made of N minus D particles. So this is surely bigger than V for N minus D particle, N minus D particle, plus 3D minus 6. Let me do this. Let me put here an equal sign and here an F of V, F being a nonlinear, very specific kind of polynomial, rational functional, non function. And for this equal sign, what I'm not explaining is the use of Euler formula. The formula that says that for planar graphs, there is a specific relation between the number of bonds and facets and atoms. So I have to use it to extract the exact value, the exact formula for this F. But then I have a strange relation. So V is bigger or equal to F of V. So what I do, I look for a fixed point, V equal to F of V. That's going to be a lower bound. So from this argument, rating gets a lower bound, V bigger than F of B, by the way, F of B is exactly this. This is a miracle, which I didn't want to, but okay, so try to prove that every configuration with endpoints has, let's say, an energy which is bigger than this one. And then the only thing that you need to show is that there are subsets of the triangular lattice, which exactly have that energy, which means that those are going to be the nanostructures. States. And when sets like this one have exactly this very value of energy, I'm not going to be computing, it's going to be not very exciting. And that's basically the end of the proof. I have to quote here that there is a point in this proof which was clarified sometimes later by Bazzi. 1983. So there was a last step in Ulisse's proof which was not clear at the beginning and was clarified later. So again, what happened? A local argument which turns into global by using global facts, like the sum of internal angles of a polygon, and global facts, the Euler formula. This gives you a lower bound on the energy. There is a maximum number of tangencies that you can do, or bonds that you can activate. And then, to show that this is really the right value, it's not too low, you show a configuration with exactly that value. And that's enough. That's enough to conclude. So if you stop for the first part of the lecture. So we start again. So I clean the board, but I left this drawing here. Now the first part we ended with this. We ended with the proof, or let's say the argument that says that ground state for this radiant potential, which is sticky with an affine part, is a subset of the triangular lattice, the regular triangular lattice. So let me compare these two possible subsets. From one side, this one. And from the other side, that one. Let's assume that they have the same number of atoms. The atoms are just sitting at the crossings of these segments. So the same number. So which one has lower energy? So it's the greatest number of bonds, that connection between atoms. This is something that Fredin didn't tell us. But the answer should be obvious. So this one is so much better because this one has least surface. And atoms which are not at the surface have six bonds. Atoms at the surface have four or even three bonds. So it should be better to have the least possible surface. It should be better to be rounded, to have least surface with the same bond. And this one is a big surface. So the bulk atoms are just this few in the middle, and all the rest is surface. So this one is a subset of the triangular lattice, but it shouldn't be a ground state. Okay. So as I said, this was left open by Radin, but it has been solved recently in a paper by Join, Fieseke, Schmidt. Just appear. You see, I told you it's an old new problem. So here's the new part. So what they proved basically in a parallel variational fashion, which I don't have time to explain now, is that if you take the number of particles and you send it to plus infinity, but at every end of a fine crystallization, what you see at the end by rescaling is that your configuration, the minimum configuration, converges in some variational sense to an isogram. So that truly the right geometry is the one with the regular isogram, like in that case. Oh, this is a positive result, and this paper is a kind of a companion paper, actually, which is not appeared yet. Oh, no, it's just appeared also this one. And this paper actually proves that. So when n goes big, ground states look like hexagon, but for every n, they can be very, very far from hexagon. So if you take, say, the distance between the ground state and the hexagon in a kind of a set way, well, this distance can be as big as n to the 3 fourth atoms. So it's true that in the limit they look like hexagons, but it's also true that at every n they can be very, very far from an isogram. So the difference in lattice size can be this big. So the atoms are n. This is more than n, it's n to the 3/4. If n is very big, this is negligible, but it's still a big number.
All right.
Okay, so this was the short range interactions in 2D. This is what we know. Let's go for a long-range interactions in 2D. Long-range, remember, is infinite crystallization, so we're going to be looking at densities. So this is infinite and long-range. So this is a frame of a very important paper by Florian Teil, which appeared in 2006. It was the first ever paper more than 1D long-range interactions. In this paper, it proves two things. It proves that If you take the limit as n goes to infinity of the energy density for ground states, you get a number which is exactly the energy per particle. That is, in this case, we are to the minimum of the sum, let's say, over let's put it, let's say that x is inside the triangular lattice, and here put v2 of c dot x respect to c. So exactly the same formula that we had in 1D, we have to look to deformed copies of the triangular lattice and choose the one that is making the best of this value, that's the energy per particle. This one is the value that you get in the limit if you take a large number of particles at the density. Okay. So this kind of results in what is called the thermodynamic limit. It says, you take a lot of particles, they, at the end, the density of the ground states looks like the one of a dilated, actually contracted copy of the triangular lattice. More than this, it also proved that, so he had to cope with infinite crystallization, right? So he said that if you impose periodic or specific well-prepared Dirichlet conditions, then you crystallize in a triangular lattice. Let's see if I can draw a picture for this. Let's do this. So I have to make a lot of triangles. Triangular lattice. So what he said, so let's assume that I kind of cut off these atoms. It's a finite number of atoms. I cut them off, I leave all the other sticks, and then I put them back again. And I look for the ground state. So all the others are fixed, just number change. This is what Dirichlet conditions mean. So all the rest is fixed. Well, in this case, you recrystallize back in the triangular lattice. Okay? So this was the result. Very big paper based on this idea of resummation of long-range interactions. So these particles have long-range interactions, it kind of represents this long-range interaction in the short range. And it was a crucial idea. Okay. This result by Tile was then extended. So what this do was this. So let's take again v equal 1 half, the sum I different from j of v2 of xi minus xj. said this was Tile's framework, in a sense. Let's add to the three body term. Plus 1/2 of the sum of V3 of theta I, j, and k. So what is theta? So I'm taking three particles, xi, xj, and xk. And then theta I, j, k is the angle which is formed by these two bodies. It's a kind of a three-body interaction. And this is why I called it V3. And what they did was to choose for the V3 something like this. So this is 2 pi. This is pi. This is 2 pi over 3. And this is 4 pi over 3. Something doing like this. Oops. Yeah. So symmetric. So that I don't have to care if I'm taking this theta or the other theta, it's going to be the same. It's symmetric, and I'm taking 1/2, so I can take both. And I have a three-body potential, which says that I want to have, it's better for me to have angles which are 2 pi over 3. In Tile setting, the angles were pi over 3, not 2 pi over 3. And here is 2 pi over 3. So here the idea is that I want to mimic the bonds in carbon. In fact, in so-called sp2 hybridized carbon, the four electrons which carbon usually has to relate, three of these four hybridized and get this kind of a planar configuration where the angles are all 2 pi over 3. So they wanted to have something like this. And in fact, this is what they had. So, so what they proved, I can put it here with a dot, they proved, so they proved Tile's results for the hexagonal lattice. In fact, by completing this picture, you get hexagons. So now I prepared a little movie of this effect. So I wanted to show the effect of this three-body term, and I did it with two simulations with 20 particles. It's a 2D simulation. It's actually a system of 20 ODEs. I'm adding like a fictitious time, and I'm flowing down the energy with a gradient flow method, just the easiest one. So on the left, so you see this little segments appearing where the distance is around 1. This is Leonard Jones. So on the left, there is no three-body term. And this is what it does. You see triangles, and you see also other structures. And And the reason for this is that this flow is not actually getting to the ground state, which is going to be triangular. It's just sticking to some intermediate metastable state where these squares are acceptable and stable. And then on the right, it's a, the same initial condition, the same scaling of time, the same, but just with the three-body interaction term. As I said, this favors hexagons, and this is what we see. This again is not a ground state, but it's a local minimizer because every angle is perfect, every distance is one, so this is a local minimizer. By the way, I can do this game. This stops. Okay. With more particles. Again, here there is no three-body term. And you see they are self-organizing this kind of triangular patterning. Again, with effects, like this one. You can see the little island down there, which gets dragged to the big island very, very slowly, but then it gets attached, and then it ends. Again, we know that this is not a ground state, because Jan Frieseke and Schmidt told us that this should be kind of rounded, and this is not rounded. It has a lot of surface. But still, it's a local minimizer. And here, what happens with the occurrence, the same initial condition, but with the three-body interaction term, this one. You prefer hexagons. They are not hexagons everywhere. This has seven bonds. That one is five, but mostly it is not hexagons. The 3D, I'll do it later. So now I mute it again. Okay, because I have to comment that this is basically, after almost 2 hours of lecture, the point where I took on this business. So I was interested in these carbon structures, like the fullerenes. For these structures, the result by EMD is not enough. And the reason is double. First of all, these structures are three-dimensional. Second, these structures are made up, in the fullerene case, by a finite number of particles, not n to infinity, no thermodynamic limit, just 60 particles. So I wanted to have something like this one, but for a finite number of particles. That's the first time since that I did. So that's the first thing that I did. So finite. This I did with it on my knee. And myself last week. Finite three body, what you have is the ground states. Are honeycomb. There are subsets of the honeycomb lattice, of the hexagonal lattice. And of course, we could express again the value of the energy, which is minus 3n over 2 minus the square root of 3n over 2. Thank you. this is exactly the radiance results. It's a radiant like. So exactly a radiant, we got the explicit value for the energy of the ground state, the leading part. And you see here, here three over two, because every atom in the hexagonal lattice has three bonds, and every bond is between two atoms, so three over two. And this is the energy part. What we did a little bit more than raising was to try to interpret some more the geometry of these ground states, which happen to be very round again. So the ground states pretty much looks like hexagons made of hexagons. I'm sure you can imagine this, and maybe picture one. Easy to make a reasonable picture of the stuff. Okay, so for instance, this one, that's a ground state for this value, which is 2, 5, okay, 19, 4 probably. So there's a 13, so 26. So for n equal to 26, that's the only ground state. Okay, and then, still talking about what I did, we extended this again with Piovano to square crystallization. So, finite and square. When I say finite, I always mean that there is short-range interactions only. And the square is that for a favor, it's not 2 pi over 3, but pi halves and 3 pi halves. This is 2 pi. So I favor the angles of the square lattice. And again, I can have conditions on potentials in such a way that ground states are square. And the energy is given. It's a little bit easy to draw squares. So I tell some more about the square case, but the hexagonal case is pretty much the same. So in the square case, we could do two things which were not there before. So the first one was to try to remove a kind of a discrete or a crystalline isoperimetric inequality. So we said just some minutes ago that the ground state which we prefer are the ones that have the least surface. If you like, the maximal area is the same. So given the surface, maximal area, or given the area, the maximal surface, that's for the in the plane, the solution is the same and it's the ball. That's the optimal case of an isoperimetric inequality. The same hold if you look to square configurations. There are subsets of the square lattice. So this is a subset of this lattice. So we define its area in the obvious sense, so this will contribute the area. And for the perimeter, we remember to we have to do a perimeter, and this may have this kind of little flags, so we count two times this flags. So what we could prove is that for every subset connected of this square lattice, the square root of the area is less than k, which depends on n, the perimeter, and this relation gets to be inequality if and only if the configuration is a Galois state. So what we said in a kind of a heuristic way is actually a theorem. So the ground state is really that subset of the square lattice, which has maximal area, if you like, or minimal perimeter surface. And you can evaluate this quantity explicitly, so you can really know what's going to be, in terms of n, the area, or the perimeter of a ground state. And that's a it's a characterization. Second, we could discuss uniqueness. So we already said all this stuff, all these ground states cannot be unique because they are because the potentials are invariant under isometry. So if this is a ground state, shifted, that's again a ground state. But it's even more to this. So usually ground states are not unique. Let's have a look to this one. For n equal 10, so here I have 10 atoms. And this is not isometric to this one. Okay? I cannot flip it or revert it in such a way that I can get one. So these two, they have the exact same energy, and the energy is 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 13. So here, with minus 13, it's the same thing. So we could classify the cases where we have uniqueness. So the uniqueness holds, the uniqueness is okay if n is a square. If it's a square plus a line, or if it's a square minus 1 point, or a square plus a line minus 1 point. And non-uniqueness in all the other cases. And the way we could do that was to use the explicit expression for the perimeter and the area, which was giving us all the information needed to decide on how many ground states we had. Okay, so let me now go to three. So in 3D we don't know much. So I think you have not much. So let's start with some intuition. In 2D we said let's try to crystallize these disks are rigid, they won't touch each other. In 3D would be let's try to crystallize spheres. Let's let's take spheres and let's put them together in such a way that we maximize the number of tangencies. This would be crystallized with a sticky potential. So the solution in 2D, at least the local solution, was easy because it was the kissing configuration. So that configuration of the disks, which realizes the kissing number, k in two dimensions is 6. So 6 disks around the central disk. So why not starting from the kissing configuration in 3D? So the kissing number in 3D happens to be 12. It took a little to understand really that it was 12. Actually, it was settled just some 60 years ago. Oh, by the way, K4 is 24, and K5 is not known. Some of the k's are known, but not as many. For instance, in 5 dimensions, we don't know how many of the spheres we can put kissing a single sphere instead. But let's focus on k3 equal to 12. You can picture in your mind what a kissing configuration is. The one that you get by putting the center of the spheres at the corners of an icosahedron. A platonic solid with 20 facets. Maybe I can draw it. I can draw it. So I can take a cube like this one. There. And then I just put a dot at the midpoint of every side. Can this be an echo side? That's a kissing configuration. And there is, of course, the central sphere is in the center of it. Okay. What's the drama of the kissing configuration in 3D? In 2D, the kissing configuration is rigid. You put your disks, you cannot move them. In 3D, it's not so. So the kissing configuration is not rigid. I'll do a 2D sketch. It's like having something like this. So you can move a little bit around these spheres. So not even the local problem is easy in 3D, because the spheres are not fixed to some specific position. They can go around a little bit. There are 12 spheres. And there is even a theorem that says that you can roll these spheres over the central one in order to make any permutation possible to this without touching. So it's really a non-rigid configuration. And on top of this, we don't have Arbor result. Remember the Arbor result? The one we were saying that the tangencies are such and such, the global result. So we don't have the local, we don't have the global, nobody really knows. So for the sticky potential in 3D, the question is completely open. You give me 60 particles in 3D sticky, I don't know what they do. But there is a very interesting intuition to a possible solution, which again appeared this year or last year. This year again, Taylor Tarasov. So they say, okay, so let's take a sphere, let's take 12 spheres, all touching this sphere, this central one. So these are 12 spheres. Let's consider all possible arrangements of these 12 spheres. So which arrangement is the one that is maximizing the number of tangencies between these 12 spheres? I said this configuration is kind of fluid. I can move these spheres. It's going to be better if the spheres touch themselves, because that's going to lower the energy. It's a local problem. It's a very hard one, and it's been solved by a computer. So it was transformed to a graph problem and then solved with a computer. And the solution is that these two configurations, which locally maximize the number of tangencies, are the so-called closed-pack 3D configuration. HCP and FCC. So HCP and FCC. HCP stands for hexagonally closed pack. Pack of packet, I don't know. And FCC stands for face centered cubic. So again, locally, we don't have a rigid kissing configuration, but the kissing configuration which maximizes the tangencies are either HCP or FCC locally. Globally, we still don't know. Now I have to explain a little bit what is HCP and FCC with another picture which I got again from the Wikipedia. I said that
they both minimize.
Among kissing configurations, so there is configuration of 12 degrees touching the central one with the same radius number of letting, HCP and FCC are those configurations which maximize the number of electric tangencies. And are the only two. Okay, so here is HCP and FCC. You have to imagine this to be balls. So you have this level of white balls on the bottom, and then you put a second level of black balls on this one, just the way you can expect. So you just have to put one black ball every time you see a hole between two white balls at the bottom. And then for the third level, you have two choices. So either you put the third level exactly over the first one, in this case, or you put the third level a little bit to the north, if you like, respect to the first one. So this one, A, corresponds to A. It's exactly on the same side. Here, C doesn't correspond really to A. You see, A is this figure here, which is. So the first one is HCP. The second is FCC. It's called cubic because if you imagine this cube here, red, you see it's really a cube where there is an extra particle in the middle of the face. So it's in the center of the face, you have an extra particle. It's FCC. Okay, so two configurations. Which one is the better? We will never be able to decide based on first order interactions because you see, so every time you stack one of this level, either ABABAB, this is HCP, or ABCABCABC, this is FCC. They have the same number of first order first neighbors. So the first order energy, short range energy, is the same. And it would be the same even if you take something more exotic like FBA, IABACBA. So no chance of deciding between this structure and the other structure of just first neighbors, because they have the same number of first neighbors, just the same. Again, videos. So this one, again, this is again a gradient flow of Lennard-Jones again. Three-dimensional, same initial condition, the same scaling of time. It's a fictitious thing. So here there is no three-body term, it's just Lennard-Jones. In fact, it's organized in such a way, if you look it close, it seems that basically every four particles are forming a regular tetrahedron, like exactly in HCP and FCC. I really like this because I wanted to have something more similar to carbon, so I decided to make some simulation again, 3D, but with the three-body term. And this is what happens. Of course, if you add in the three-body term, the structure likes most angles with charm hexagonal-like. They form hexagons like that, but still it's not planar, see? It's not a planar structure. So the fact that all angles are the right one is not making it planar, like graphene. And so I decided to make another simulation by boosting this three-body term very much. At the end, we know that if this doesn't exist, the crystallization is triangular. If it exists and it's big, it should be hexagonal. So I decided to make it very, very big. So it took, maybe from the second to the third picture, 100 times bigger three-body term. And I must confess to my surprise, this is, again, not planar at all. Maybe I can speed up. I don't know if I can. It switches a couple of times. This is basically the end of the story. No, this is the end of the story. And you see there is one guy which is on an hexagonal up there on top. It has 7 bonds, but if you go in there and measure, every bond is exactly 2π/3. Because in 3D you have more space, and you can arrange also things which are non-planar with the exact number. So this is locally stable. It's a local minimizer, but it's not planar. Do I have anything here more? Mute. Yeah? Mute. Okay, so now let me talk about... I'm sorry, I'm stupid. I want to show one more thing. Okay, so let me talk about carbon now. Is it over? Carbon. So we said in 2D, we have the kind of picture there. We have a thin. And the idea is to use this 2D structure, actually graphene is 2D, and to roll it up, or roll it up 2 times, to construct something which is more 3D. Right? Again, the second, and the first one and the second row, maybe all this, I took it from the net. So that tube that you see there is usually called a carbon nanotube or a single wall carbon nanotube. You can imagine it as a rolled up version of graphene. Take graphene, you cut it, and you roll it up, and you get a nanotube like that one. This molecule here is called coranulene. This is a pentacoranulene. These are non-planar molecules made of pure carbon. This is just pure carbon. And then 3 examples of fullerenes. The first one has exactly 60 atoms. It's called C60 because of this, because it has 60 atoms. The second one is C20. It's an icosahedron. It's the smallest possible fullerene. And this is C70. It's exactly like C60 with an extra row of hexagons. C60, how is it made? It's made by 12 pentagons, regular and planar. And to each side of this pentagon, in this, let us look to this one, you attach an hexagon, regular and planar. This structure closes, if you imagine pentagons to be black and hexagon to be white, that's a soccer ball. You don't know it. Okay. It's almost the same for C20, 12 pentagons, again planar. And for C70, again, 12 pentagons. So the definition, in a sense, of fullerene is a carbon cage closed with 12 pentagons and an unrestricted number of hexagons. And these are just 3 examples of these structures which have been detected. So on this slide, you see 2 Nobel Prizes. The discovery of the fullerene, which happened in the mid-80s, brought to the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1996 to Crotto and Smalley. And the production of a, let's say, isolated graphene sheet brought the Nobel Prize in Physics to Beni and Novoselov in 2010. These are amazing materials which have incredible mechanical and electronical properties and are believed to be the most promising materials to mankind for electronics and pharmaceutics. So I wanted to tackle this stuff. So I get back to graphene that you see there. And I try to think about what you see there, which is the way we want to picture nanotubes. So nanotubes should be imagined like strips cut into the dot lines and then rolled up. This arrow that you see is the identification. That's the roll-up, the direction in which you roll up. You can take basically any direction. It could be horizontal in that case. you get a nanotube with a specific geometry, which is the one depicted here. It's called the zigzag nanotube, or it can be a little bit more tilted, and you get other geometries of nanotubes. The nanotubes all are different. They have different diameters and different geometries. Okay, so let me see if I convince you that with a very simple setting that we're looking at, we can say something about this structure. So the first thing that I want to show you is that, okay, so I need it. So I want to show you first thing that the graphene is not a ground state. This hexagonal-like interactions into D finite, then the ground state is graphene. So what if I imagine everything in 3D? So I don't restrict it to D and I just allow them to be 3D. Then graphene is not a ground state anymore because it's always convenient if you have a nice big patch of graphene to roll it up. Now let's see if I can convince you about this. So I'm taking a chunk of graphene. Okay, so let's say that this chunk is L long, whatever L means, and W wide. Whatever W means, it's a measure of how many atoms I have. And then I imagine that I want to roll it up. So I want to roll it up in this direction and create new bonds like this. I hope you can see it. So I'm taking the blackboard and I'm rolling it up. So what happens to the energy? Of course, I gain something because by rolling up, I activate new bonds, and every new bond is giving me a minus one. So the energy gain is actually the loss is proportional to minus L. Because for every of this L, I get an extra bond. But by rolling up, I am kind of distorting these angles, which were here optimal, 2 pi over 3, to something different, a little bit smaller, not optimal, so I'm gaining some energy. So that's the energy gain, this is the energy rise. It can be computed explicitly how big is this energy rise. So the angles are perturbed of something that goes like 1 over W squared, and then how many angles you have, basically you have W times L angles. So this is basically L of W. Okay, so the delta energy, I would call it delta of V, is minus L plus a constant maybe L of W. This is just a scaling, yeah? Which tells me that whatever L I have, if I take W very, very big, that's a big slab, then it's going to be convenient to roll it up. So for N large, graphene is not going to be a ground state in 3D for my functional. okay? Because it's always better to work out. So when I found this, I thought, well, this could be kind of intuition on why we should see all our structures. It's not, in fact, because I cannot prove that nanotubes are ground states. I can prove in some specific case that ground nanotubes are local minimizers, which is even more important because we should agree that reality is not really looking to ground states, but better to local minimizers. In fact, also graphene is a local minimizer. But there is another computation on nanotubes that I'd like to show you, which I will entitle nanotubes R1. Nanotubes are very long structures. They can be as long as 10 to the 8 their diameter. Very, very elongated structures. And so here's a scaling that was indicated to me by Alexander Mielke. So let's take again a slab of graphene, like this one, L, W. So inside here you have N equals W times L atoms. And we said that they probably would like to roll out. Okay, so it's rolling up. And now I'm adding atoms, so I'm giving you more atoms and more atoms. And I'd like to see what's going to be the aspect ratio of this tube. So again, so the energy, so delta V is going to be something like minus L plus K L over W. K is a number. I don't know. It depends. I can be very precise on K if I specify what's the geometry of the nanotube. Is it a zigzag? Is it an armchair? It's an entry. And now I want to remember that actually I can write W in terms of N and L here. So 1 over W is L over N. So this is minus L plus K L squared over N. So now you give me N atoms, I do whatever I like, I have this relation, I want to find what's the best possible L. Right? Which means what's the L that minimizes the delta V. Right? And that's the L optimal, if you like. L optimal is 1 over N over 2K. So what's important is that L optimal scales with N, and since L and W scale with N, this means that W scales is a constant, it's a constant. So W optimal has to be a constant. So what I just proved by this argument, this scaling argument, is that if I give you the double, the triple, 10 times the number of atoms, the best possible roll-up energy is going to be that one that corresponds to the structure, which is a double, the triple, 10 times longer, not thicker. So the diameter is always the same, because W optimal is constant. The length is scaled with N, so if I add atoms, it grows. So again, I found this remarkable, the very easy functional tells us something which looks like what is observed. Of course, it's not. It's like a cartoon of what is it.
All right.
Okay, so I'd like to come to my last point. So we said graphene is not a ground state, but still, graphene is there, right? So these two guys and their lab got a Nobel Prize because they showed the possibility of producing such a two-dimensional crystal. Of course, it's not to us to argue with our easy functional why it's so. But I'd like to give you an argument that says that graphene is actually a local inclusive, also in three dimensions. So what I'd like to discuss is stability. So which of these structure is stable to perturbation, mechanical perturbation, in the sense that little movements of the atoms. And I like to do so for the fullerenes. So I like to prove with my method that the stability of C60. As you will see, the proof is short, immediate, and almost elementary. And I like it very much because in the community studying this structure, this idea of stability is very much debated. So you can produce this cages of carbon. Again, so there are closed cages of carbon with 12 pentagons, regular, and an unrestricted number of electrons. You can produce it with any number of atoms, starting from 20, excluding 22. Up. And if you consider this Cn with n less or equal to 80, they are exactly 222,509 isomers, which means different possibility of positioning these particles, which are not isometric one to the other in any sense. So they are not homeomorphic one to the other. You cannot change one to the other in a continuous way. Right? So this is what geometry tells us. And the reality tells us that from this 200 and something thousand, just a bunch like 12 or 15 are observable. And people is asking why? Why is it so? Why is 15 are there and the other 200,000 not? Of course, the answer should be that these other 200,000, for some reason, are less favorable or less stable. So arguments in favor of stabilities of those which we see are being sought since the 80s, since the discovery of these structures. So let's see why C6A is stable, meaning it's a local minimizer or a functional. So this is a local minimizer of E. So again, what is C60? It's the soccer ball. So it's a kind of a ball with these pentagons. And then hexagons. And when you finish your hexagon, you start again with a pentagon and you go on. Okay, so let's compute the energy of some perturbation. Some perturbation of C60. Perturbation means that every single atom of C60 is a little bit tilted to the left, to the right, up or down, just a little bit. It's a small perturbation, it's very, very small. So pentagons are still pentagons, hexagons are still hexagons, and so on. So in particular, I will use probably a P or maybe a PI to identify the angle of a pentagon, and then XI or HI for the angle of an hexagon. Right. So let's compute this energy. This energy is 1/2 of the sum I different from J of the V2. So xi minus xj, this xi xj are the perturbed. And then the three-body term. The three-body term has two pieces. One piece is the v3 of the hexagonal angles, and the other piece is the v3 of the pentagonal angles, meaning angles of pentagons, angles of hexagons. Now, Now the first term is surely bigger than minus 90. Because we have 60 atoms, each of which has 3 bonds. 60 by 3 is 180, but each bond is shared by 2 atoms. So it's 180 over 2, 90. Okay, so this is surely bigger than that. Because minus 1 is the minimum of V2, so minus 90. This term here is surely positive, so I forget about this one. And this term here, I forgot a 1/2. So this term here, face by face, by summing up this one, you get the internal angles of a pentagon. Assume that this is convex around the minimum, then you can get a sum inside. So this is bigger than 12 times, 5 times, V3 at 3 pi over 5. That's the angle of the pentagon. I'm sorry, so 12 times, 5 times. Okay, so this is a lower bound. As soon as you have one couple which is a distance different from one, this is strict. As soon as you have one angle which is not hexagonal exact, this is strict. As soon as you have one angle of these pentagons which is not exact, 3 pi over 5, this is strict again. And this last line that I see here is exactly the energy of C60. So any perturbation of C60, small perturbation, has a bigger energy, and it's the same just if it's C60. This means that C60 is a local minimizer of P. So sitting your simulation in C60 is going to stay there. There is a little trick hiding in this. I use this here, the fact to compute this term here, I use the fact that C60 has planar facets. So all the facets in C60 are planar, and this I kind of, this is an argument that I didn't give here. I'm not commenting this. So I can use this argument for every possible structure of carbon made of pentagons, hexagons, such that every pentagon and hexagon is planar, stays on a plane. So the same argument. So this is a good one. C20, the icosahedron, and to coranulene, and structures made on coranulene, and graphene. Also, graphene is a collection of carbon atoms made of planar hexagons, so that's stable, meaning that local is a minimizer, not a global minimizer, but local is a minimizer. And this is my connection to the Nobel Prize. The bad news is that apart from C60 and C20, no other fullerene has planar faces. So the 222,509, two of these have planar faces, and my argument applies, and the others do not have planar faces, so I cannot use my argument to select which of those I allegedly want. Another bad thing, no nanotube has obviously planar faces. So apart from this, sorry, let me conclude this sentence, apart from C16 and C20, no fullerene has planar faces. And the second bad thing is that even no nanotube Okay, so graphene, coranulene, pentacoranulene, C60, C20, there's all local minimizers. This I don't know. The nanotube I don't know. They don't have planar faces, I cannot do. So now I'm 7 on 7, so I have to switch to the movies which are behind. Let's play a little bit with stability here. So again, same initial conditions. Here you see colors because I wanted to picture also the energy. Blue is a very nice energy. And you see it's shared by those dots which have a lot of bonds. And black and red is bad energy. And here, this is with noise. So I'm doing a gradient flow with a little bit of noise in order to help explore the energy landscape to see something can get better. The curve that you see there is the energy as a function of this fictitious time. Here with some noise. And the structure gets a little bit better. You see that dots are kind of vibrating a little bit. That's a noise. And again, more noise. And this is very, very noisy, but you see the structure is a little bit surround, right? And the blue dots are more, it seems to be more. The energy is lower, although it goes up and down.
Maybe you can reconnect the cable if it's just mechanical.
That's it.
It's not.
So noise can help, but it's not really, I just wanted to show this, because I wanted to comment on stability, 3D. So this was with a little noise, the packing is very dense. And this is with a little noise, but also some three body term. And you see the emergence of this, you should see the emergence of this, the trigonal structures. It's not really. The fullerene here is with some noise, so I'm checking stability. For checking stability, for me, is like to add some random perturbation of the position of the atom and let them flow. Here, the three body term is very weak, and what happens is this whole structure collapses into a densely packed one. Here the three-body term is stronger, and the fullerene remains a fullerene. Of course, the energy is always changing. This is why you see these colors changing. So the angles are always changing in a random fashion, but it still is all the time a fullerene. And the same for the coranuline. Here there is cramps like this because there is not that much of a free body term. And here it stays, so this one is stable. So the nanotube. For the nanotube, as I said, I don't have this argument because nanotubes are not, they do not have planar facets. So I cannot apply this argument. I have another argument though that says that especially this geometry, which is the zigzag geometry, is stable with some specific geometric prescriptions. So this is the geometry of the nanotube. There is no perturbation, there is no randomness. This one is a little bit perturbed, and you see it's floating around. Dots are red at the end because it's, they are open, so they are lacking one bond, but it's always this red, and it's always this round almost. What we have discovered by this is this
question,
yes.
The last one. I mean, I'm not very familiar with nanotubes, but why isn't it a torus or a ring? Is it not that stable? I mean, we're looking for minimizers, so why don't we have a ring? I like rings.
So in a sense, the scaling argument and just the one for rolling up the graphene would tell us that it's going to be better to take a very long nanotube and to roll it up in a torus. That's for sure, because we activate extra bonds and we pay less and less and less the longer the torus is. But here we're not looking to global minimizers. I don't think that the torus is still a global minimizer. We're talking about local minimizers. And for that one, that's what we do. So from a technological perspective, nanotubes are not open. They don't exist to be open. They just have kind of caps, which are pieces of balls. So they are closed in a sense, but they're not fluorescents.
One other question. Is it just a visualization or so? Because when you showed the deformed C60, then you could see that the different carbon atoms had changing energy, so the color changed here. You couldn't see it. Is it just that the change in energy is so small that it's still all blue, or?
It's
okay.
There is a change of energy.
So is the change of energy here relatively smaller than the change in C60?
Yes, but this makes probably, so to my point of view, makes no sense to consider now because quantitatively everything is
okay.
Wrong at this level. So
okay.
I think we can say just a matter of not an optimal showing of the results.
Yeah.
In fact, you see the energy, which is that line there, it seems to be constant. It's not, you see some dot over in it. So
yeah.
I should have said this maybe better.
I was just wondering why it doesn't change.
So here is a nanotube again. Maybe I can do it. So this goes around. This is a simulation that we did for this periodic condition. Nanotube is very long, and we didn't want to have this endpoint. So this is a periodic simulation. The length of the nanotube changes. So this is a perfection of minimization. And what we found, which was already in a sense present in the literature, but we did give a proof for this, is that by restricting to the geometry of that kind, the minimizer is the one that minimizes this kind of energy that you see. It's not the cross and not the square. The cross and the square are the classical models for this nanotube. So the minimizer is not exactly the classical model, whatever it means. At least two models competing. One is the so-called traditional rolled up, and the other one is the cross seal. They don't exactly match. And they don't correspond to the minimum of this function. And so this minimum that we see here, I can do with respect to some restricted family of perturbation that is a local minimizer.
What's alpha?
This is a good question. So alpha is the angle that you see between the yellow bonds, is the geometric parameter which is describing the whole structure. And there is an optimal alpha, which is not exactly present by now in the literature.
But for next step, you should wait for the next thing. And with this, I'm stopping and I'm taking this. In a sense, if I could make a very, very long nanotube and close it, like a donut, the energy of this closed configuration would be lower than that of the open nanotube. But there is not such a process possible technologically. These are very long structures, so as I said.
But the angle between the other
ones.
Sorry?
So the change is going to be lower order. So we're going to come to the game. So the donut is going to have a lower energy, but this one is still a local minimizer. So if my evolution gets close to this one, it will never go to the donut. So let's say it this way. I have a very long open nanotube. They never open, but let's say it's open. By bending it and connecting it, I will have a lower energy, but by passing from one configuration to the other, the energy is going to be much bigger. So then I just go higher and higher, and then at the end, and this will not happen in nature, unless I really do it. But I don't think it's doable. No, I don't know. There is a phase transition. There is an energy barrier before this correction.
More questions? Thanks again.
No, thank you. I mean, again.